I invite you to a few moments of silence to gather ourselves as we continue to listen for God's Spirit. Speak, Lord, for your servants are listening. Amen. Banquets. We got a party in the gospel today. They show up a lot in scripture. There's, of course, the wedding at Cana, where Jesus does his first miracle and changes the water into wine. There is the celebration after the return of the prodigal son. Multiple parables, like the one we hear today, in which Jesus speaks of hosts and guests. Think about your own experiences of banqueting. I think of weddings in the family or, you know, dances of some sort. Banquets are times of celebration, of recreation. Everybody is well fed. There's dancing and conversation. There's laughter. It's warm and it's noisy. The final image of a banquet in Scripture is found near the end of the book of Revelations, the marriage supper of the Lamb, a glorious eschatological metaphor for the completion of God's commonwealth, where all is well, everybody is fed, there's dancing and conversation, there are no tears. We will sit around that banquet table together and dwell in God's presence always, which is light itself. This banquet is the end for which all creation groans, the hope for which we wait expectantly. Social interaction in Jesus' day was based on a shame and honor economy. Banquets were a kind of social theater that displayed and reinforced a person's social status. Banquets could be used to give honor to important people and get some payback yourself for doing so. But banquets could also be used to put people down. If you wanted to know where you stood in the social hierarchy, accepting a dinner invitation would probably answer that question for you. You would most definitely and literally be put in your place. Jesus, in the gospel this morning, gives some common sense advice, really, on how to avoid public shame and how to gather up public honor. He basically says, go in low and then wait to be called up to a higher place, to be publicly admired for your humility and honored by your host. And then, when everybody's kind of nodding and, you know, approving of this sage social advice, Jesus cranks it up several notches. In fact, he upends things, as he usually does. You see, the other part of the story includes Jesus' recommendations regarding who to invite in the first place. To secure your place in this shame and honor system, it was appropriate to invite friends, family, rich neighbors. The expectation was for a reciprocal invitation so that you, in turn, could be honored, so the circle would be closed. It's very transactional. But here, Jesus says something different. He says, don't invite anybody who could possibly pay you back or elevate your status. Invite the outcasts who will, in fact, lower your status. Step into their shame, very literally, by taking it on yourself. Stop playing these silly games of social scorekeeping, of balancing the books in your relationships. Honor those who cannot give you honor, and your reward will be great, where it counts, in my commonwealth. Jesus transforms the social theater into an opportunity to store up treasures in heaven. So that's the setup this morning. There's great value in Scripture as it teaches us about how to behave. But the most basic reason we're given Scripture is to know about God, to experience God, to enter relationship with God. So, what does this story teach about who God is? Religion has, for many, I'm afraid, kind of spoiled things. Religion traditionally tells us that when we come to God's banquet, there's a certain spiritual economy going on. There is a meeting out of grace in most of our religion. Keeping track, keeping score. We honor God, we obey, we repent, we give, we serve. We do all the things that good religious people should do. Then God, meeting God's end of the bargain, forgives us, takes care of us, rewards us with wealth, health, and above average children. It's a transaction. Then Jesus upends things, as he usually does. He tells us about God's foolish, and lavish invitation to all the spiritual losers, all those who, spiritually speaking, are poor and lame and blind. And what Jesus is saying in this parable becomes so much more than some sort of good advice about getting God to honor you. He gives us a picture of how God plays host at this great banquet of God's commonwealth, inviting those that can give him nothing, cannot repay the invitation, cannot give God honor of any kind. Putting these stories side by side transforms a sort of celestial accounting in religion into a deep relationship with God. It contrasts a concern over right behavior with God's ridiculous grace. We Episcopalians can be notoriously smug about the superiority of our liturgy, about the intelligence and critical thinking skills we bring to bear on our lives of faith. These are good things, but we tend, I think, to seat ourselves at God's banquet a good bit forward of those other, more simple, Free Church, Bible-thumping Christians, bless their hearts. Who are the spiritual losers? Who are the poor, the lame, the blind, broken spiritually? Well, us. Where we have tried and failed, where we thought we had the answers, and then we were painfully and suddenly awakened to our blindness and our folly. Where we have had little faith disguised as great certainty. The good news for all us sinners and saints is this: in the eyes of God, you are enough exactly as you are. You are loved exactly as you are. You are invited to feast and celebrate and dance exactly as you are. Does that mean you don't have room to grow? No. Does that mean there aren't things in your life that perhaps need to change? Absolutely not. What it does mean is that God sees past those things and loves you fully. Now, no transactional good behavior needed on your part to earn that love. When you hear that God loves you, how does that sit? Have you heard that so many times, God loves you, it feels kind of like a cliche? When I was younger, I tended to disregard positive things my mom said to me. You know, your mom compliments your work or encourages you, saying she knows you can do something, or maybe even says you look nice today. And if you're like me, as a younger person, you kind of roll your eyes and say, yeah, you have to say that, you're my mom. So somehow, those words don't count, right? As I've gotten older and hopefully wiser, I realize something, probably the result of becoming a mother myself. When my mom looks at me, the overriding experience she has in her heart is love for me. And when she says something like, "You'll land on your feet," or "That's a nice picture," she's actually saying, "I love you." When you hear the good news of God's love for you, that's not a throwaway line that preachers say from the pulpit because we have to. It's the starting and ending point of every bit of God's revelation to us. God loves you. And despite that you and I are spiritual losers, that we are poor and lame and blind and broken, God's love sees past those things, sees only the child that God loves, sees only the beloved who is invited to the banquet. The Eucharist, our banquet, is an outward and visible sign of an inward and spiritual grace. This table isn't it. This isn't the heavenly banquet itself, but it is a symbol of it, kind of a pointer toward the great cosmic banquet where we are all invited, seated at the table together, welcomed and honored and fed and loved. This Eucharist is a reminder that Jesus came to join earth to heaven and heaven to earth. It is a reminder of a life lived to show us God, a life destroyed to show us how to let go, how to fail, a life resurrected to show us that we too can live again, both in this life and in the life to come. A life given so that we are freed from slavery, healed of our infirmities, forgiven of our sins, and welcomed home from exile. From the Christian community at Iona, this is the table not of the church, but of the Lord. It is to be made ready for those who love him and who want to love him more. So, come, you who have much faith and you who have little. You who have been here often, you who have not been for a long time. You who have tried to follow and you who have failed. Come, not because it is we who invite you, it is our Lord. It is his will that those who want him should meet him here. Amen.